There was a lot of doubt. There's a lot of I told you so in the room. And the question is, well, what can we do?
At one point, Martin simply gets up and leaves the conversation and walks away into his bedroom.
One of the things we have to remember is that this is a room full of preachers, and this is Easter weekend. And that is a big time. And if you've got a church, you've got to be there on Easter. And he's sitting there talking to him, saying, we've got to do something this weekend that means that we may not be able to be in our church. And the tension and the opposition from people like his father was there, saying, you've got to come home to Ebenezer. That's where we belong on Easter. And he's saying, we need to do something dramatic instead. And he retreated to a room saying, I have to pray over this. And when the door to the room opened, Dr. King comes out in blue jeans. And the fact that he came out in blue jeans is announcing, I'm not going to the service with the flowers and the anthems and the great choirs on Easter. I'm going somewhere in blue jeans, which meant jail. Believed in and preached in unmerited suffering as redemptive, but this is the first time where he consciously chose a path to suffering. I'm going to walk into the teeth of suffering because that's the only thing I can see here that will that can rescue this huge gamble that we've taken. So he's taking a step toward it, because believe me, he didn't want to go into the Birmingham jail. And if you see the photographs of the way they're taking him into the Birmingham jail, he's a relatively small man, and the cops are lifting him up by his pants. There's no respect for the fact that this is Dr. King. This is somebody that's going to have a national holiday name for him. This is another nigger going to jail.
They had Dr. King in solitary confinement. And he was incensed at the article that five or six clergymen in Birmingham had put in the local paper, criticizing Dr. King for coming, about it wasn't a good time and all of that business. But it was always the old arguments of the status quo.
He wanted to respond, and so he used the time in jail to respond. That was the so-called letter from the Birmingham jail.
And he began to write on whatever was available. Edge of newspapers, toilet paper.
He was so upset that he had to tune out the whole rest of the world to write this letter.
My dear fellow clergymen, I came across your recent statement calling my present activities unwise and untimely. I cannot sit idly by in Atlanta and not be concerned about what happens in Birmingham. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly.
Dr. King comes out of the Birmingham jail. He's written the letter. He's put himself on the line. He's invited suffering. And it still didn't make any difference. But James Bevel is coming to King saying, we're out of jail volunteers. You're going to jail didn't produce the ones that we hoped it would. But if you're out of adults, I got high school students, because he's holding these youth meetings.
Andy Young and James Bevel wanted permission to to use the children. And in the beginning, Dr. King was opposed to using the children. But Bevel and Andy Young prevailed.
I listened to him speak, you know, and watch him just to see him, you know, how he would sweat and how powerful he sounded. And you know, just the impact on what he said, the words just stayed there in the air, you know, as he talked.
He took all of the fear out. Even though he was talking about doing serious things here in the city of Birmingham, he took all of the fear out of you.
The people in the rest of the country with the vivid pictures of fire hoses and police dogs attacking children and black citizens were in a very dramatic way exposed to the just exactly what racism meant and how fiercely the South was defending it.
Martin King was convinced the people of Birmingham would not tolerate police acting in their name, slamming little girls up against the wall and fire hoses, and having dogs attack kids. They grew up in segregation, and they may not agree with him, but there's a limit. Enough's that's too much.
As the result of responsible efforts on the part of both white and Negro leaders over the last 72 hours, the business community of Birmingham has responded in a constructive and commendable fashion and pledged that substantial steps would begin to meet the justifiable needs of the Negro community.
Dr. King, how big a victory is this for the American Negro?
Well, I think this is a very significant victory, not only for the American Negro, but for the country. I have always felt that a victory in Birmingham would mean a great deal in breaking down the barriers of segregation.
The implications of coming out from Birmingham are very profound, and Dr. King recognized that it had touched people in mass numbers. And that's why he said on the telephone to Clarence Jones, his lawyers back here in New York, we are on a breakthrough. We have to do something that will make a landmark.
Martin went to Washington to lobby for the Civil Rights Bill. Kennedy said, well, you see, Dr. King, is that I understand I'm from Massachusetts, but I have the Southern Congress to deal with, and they're not ready yet.
Bayard Rustin and A. Philip Randolph had talked about a march on Washington for years. So Bayard called and asked if he could come down and meet with us, and that Mr. Randolph was willing to lead and organize this march on Washington.
My first conversation with Bobby Kennedy said, look, you all really shouldn't be doing this. You know, there are so many things that can happen. Just little people can disturb it. You could have the town burning and it won't work.
I think the Kennedy administration and certainly Robert Kennedy and the president had enormous respect for Dr. King, and they were hopeful about the march. But they didn't feel that they could afford to be clearly identified with it.
Testing. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Bayard Rustin and I went out to the mall about maybe 5 a.m., 6 a.m., and we looked around and there was nobody on the mall. And then just as Bayard said, do you think anybody's coming to the march, a group from Virginia, NAACP youth group, came up on the mall. And then we found out that nobody was there because the highways were jammed with buses trying to get into Washington.